Well, it looks like we're all here and it is 7 p.m.
Okay, and we're live. So I will call the regular meeting of the Capitola Planning Commission to order for the March 4th, 2021 meeting. And for those of you that are tuned in to us tonight, welcome. And just call we are not meeting physically, we're meeting via Zoom. And there are several ways that you can participate in this meeting: by calling the number shown on the screen. You can enter the webinar by using that number that's shown on the screen, or you can also, once you're in, dial 9 to raise your hand if you'd like to speak. So as always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and AT&T UVerse Channel 99, and it's recorded and replayed the following Monday and Friday at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. And you can also view them live from the city's website. And our technician tonight is Noel Cabe. With that, we have the roll call, please, Edna.
Sure. Commissioner Christensen?
Here.
Commissioner Newman?
Here.
Commissioner Westman?
Here.
Commissioner Wilk?
Here.
Chair Ruth?
Here.
Thank you very much.
And now, if everyone would please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America, to the republic for which we stand, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
With liberty and justice for all. We need a little practice on that. Okay, the next item on the agenda is oral communications. Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda, Katie?
There are. This evening, I'd like to pull item 4C from the agenda. This is the conditional use permit for the storage of vehicles. Under our new code, temporary uses are approved administratively. So I'm going to be doing a review of this. We caught this after publication. So we won't be treating it the way we have in the past as an item that is not within the zone, but it's an administrative review. I'll be taking a really close look at the site again before my review, and we'll be moving forward from there. The Planning Commission would be the appeal board on this if my decision were to be appealed. So we cannot comment on it this evening, but I would like you to know that I'll be doing a thorough review of that application. And our city attorney brought it to my attention that we should no longer process it the way in which we have in the past.
Okay. Thank you, Katie. Any questions for Katie on that item before we leave her update? Okay, seeing none, now's the time for public comments. This is for comments that pertain to items that are not on the agenda. And again, you would need to use those numbers we've showed at the beginning of the meeting to make a comment. So we'll give you a minute or two to make a comment if you have anything to say about any item that's not on the agenda.
And I'm reviewing the I'm watching the emails this evening, and I don't see any public comments that are for items not on the agenda within our public comments emails.
Okay, then we'll move on to commission comments. Any commissioners have any comments tonight? Seeing no hands raised. Staff comments?
Ed did.
Oh, sorry, Ed.
I would like to have a discussion after the public hearing, if that's acceptable to the chair, of the issue of compliance with our sign ordinance as it pertains to our job of approving applications.
Okay, following the last public hearing?
Well, we had three public hearings. Now we're down to two. So if we have time, I don't think it'll take a long time, but I'd like to get input from the other commissioners on my concerns.
Okay, we could do that under item six, the commission communications.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other commission comments? Seeing none, then any additional staff comments?
No additional staff comments this evening.
Okay, then that brings us to our public hearings. And tonight, our first public hearing is on 205 El Salto Drive.
Oh. Minutes?
Minutes, I'm sorry, missed the minutes. Planning Commission minutes. We have minutes from the meeting of January 21st and also from the minutes of February 4th. And are there any additions, corrections, or deletions to the minutes? Do we have a motion to approve?
This is Commissioner Wilk. I move we approve both the minutes from January 21st and February 4th.
You have a second?
And I second the motion.
Okay, Commissioner Newman seconds the motion. May I have the roll call, please, Edna?
Sure. Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
And Chair Ruth?
Aye.
Thank you very
much. The motion carries and the minutes are approved. Now we're at the public hearings. So the first public hearing is 205 El Salto Drive, and this is for a design permit for a first and second story addition and a new basement for an existing non-conforming single-family residence with variances for the required parking space dimensions, landscape strip in the front setback, and to exceed the non-conforming structural alteration limit within the R1 zone. And this is a public hearing. And when we get to the public portion, if anybody would like to comment on this application, again, we will show the phone numbers and how you do that. So staff report, please.
Thank you, Chair Ruth, commissioners. I would like to mention, I apologize to you, Chair Ruth. I must have been living in the past when I made this agenda because I left Commissioner Newman as the chair. So I'll make sure to fix that in the minutes for the record. All right. So tonight we have 205 El Salto Drive. The existing residence at 205 El Salto Drive, as you mentioned, is non-conforming. It's one-story single-family residence. The lot is in the Depot Hill neighborhood. It's surrounded by one and two-story single-family homes. The home is located 2 inches from the front property line. Similar to most properties on Depot Hill, there's a 10-foot-wide section of unutilized right-of-way between the home and the paved street, which the owner has landscaped, as you can see here. The property is listed on the 2005 City of Capitola Historic Structures List because it's included in the 2004 Depot Hill Feasibility Study. So with any project that amends a historic resource, preliminary historic evaluation was conducted by architectural historian Leslie Dill to determine whether the structure is a significant historic resource. That report concluded that the structure itself is not eligible as a historic resource. However, because it is located within the boundaries of a potential historic district neighborhood and is between two identified contributing properties, the architectural historian recommended that the design of any addition should be in accordance with the significance of the neighborhood based on the materials, size, scale, and massing of the surrounding contributing buildings. And that the Architectural and Site Review Committee take this into consideration when reviewing the project design and providing feedback to you, the Planning Commission. The existing residence is non-conforming, as I mentioned, because it encroaches into the required front setback as well as the side yard setback, as shown on the survey here. Here's the proposed site plan. I just called out the two parking spaces, the location of the addition, and the small rear deck. Here's the existing and proposed first story plan with the addition on the rear, which is on the right-hand side of the screen. And then the proposed second story floor plan and basement floor plan. These are located directly above and below the rear addition on the first story. So here we have the existing and proposed front elevations. and existing and proposed rear elevations. And the west. And the east. We can come back to these later if we need to. As you mentioned, the applicant has requested variances for the required parking space dimensions, the landscape strip requirement in the front setback, and the non-conforming structural alteration limit. I will go through those now, one by one. So pursuant to the Capitola Municipal Code, the Planning Commission may grant a variance when it makes two findings, the one shown here regarding special circumstances and the fact that it does not constitute the grant of a special privilege. We're all very familiar with these, but we have to show them so the public can see them each time. The Capitola Municipal Code requires that the proposed structure have two on-site parking spaces that are 9 feet wide by 18 feet deep. However, due to the location of the existing structure, the applicant can really only fit two parking spaces in the side yard if one parking space is 8 feet wide by 16 feet deep and the other is 7 feet wide by 16 feet deep. This is the location of the current parking. In relation to variance finding A, the subject property is very small by Capitola standards at only 2,400 square feet, with also with a narrow street frontage of 30 feet. Typical property width on Depot Hill and in a lot of our neighborhoods actually is 40 feet. The existing driveway substandard dimensions are common within the neighborhood, and due to the property size and the width along the street frontage, the strict application of parking standards would deprive the subject property of privileges enjoyed by other properties in the vicinity. In relation to variance finding B, staff reviewed characteristics of adjacent properties on the same block of El Salto Drive. The majority of properties on this block have either no on-site parking or substandard on-site parking space dimensions, similar to 205 El Salto Drive. Therefore, we don't believe the approval of a variance would constitute a grant of special privilege. In terms of the required landscaping adjacent to the side property line, the Capitola Municipal Code requires on-site parking to include 2 feet of landscaping between the parking area and the side property line to provide a little spacing between them and the neighboring property. As I mentioned before, due to the location of the existing structure, the applicant can fit the two required on-site parking spaces with substandard dimensions, but not the required landscape area adjacent to the side property line. Similar to the first variance request in relation to variance finding A, it is a very small lot with a narrow street frontage, and the house takes up the majority of that street frontage. The existing driveway's lack of a landscaping strip is common within the neighborhood, and therefore we believe the strict application of the landscaping requirement would deprive the subject property of privileges enjoyed by other properties. And in relation to variance finding B, staff reviewed characteristics of adjacent properties, and the majority of those properties do not provide 2 feet of landscaping between required parking spaces in the front setback and the side lot line. Therefore, we don't believe the approval of a variance would grant special privilege. In terms of the third, the non-conforming structural alteration limit, the existing residence is very non-conforming. The Capitola Municipal Code states that structural alterations to an existing non-conforming structure that exceed 80% of the present fair market value of the structure may not be made unless the structure is brought into compliance with the current zoning regulations. In order to do that, we have an 80% non-conforming calculation, which the applicant submitted. And it demonstrated that the proposed alterations are 132% of the present fair market value of the structure. So therefore, under the code, those alterations are not permissible. Generally, the larger non-conforming structure is, the more likely it is that a significant addition will comply with the non-conforming alteration limit because the present fair market value in the formula is based on existing square footage. In this case, the small square footage of the existing structure makes it difficult to do any significant additions that are under the non-conforming alteration limit. So in relation to variance finding A, as I've already mentioned, it's a very small property. The non-conforming structure, while not itself historic, was built in 1947 in a location that was previously occupied by a similarly sized outbuilding since at least 1905, and is located within a potential Depot Hill Historic District. And the existing structure is small in size of 675 square feet. The small home on the relatively small lot limits the size of an addition which complies with the non-conforming structural alteration limit to well below the maximum allowable floor area for the lot size. Therefore, the strict application of the non-conforming alteration limit would deprive the subject property of privileges enjoyed by other properties in the vicinity. And in relation to variance finding B, Once again, staff reviewed characteristics of adjacent properties on the same block. The majority of the properties do not comply with the required front or side setbacks, and many on the adjacent street, especially Central Avenue, have received variances to exceed the non-conforming structural alteration limit. Therefore, the approval of a variance would not be a grant of special privilege inconsistent with limitations on other properties. So that, staff recommends Planning Commission review and approve project 20-0506 based on the conditions of approval and findings.
Okay. Thank you, Matt. Are there any questions for the staff?
Got a question. Commissioner Wilk?
Yeah.
I noticed on that last slide we had a tree was on their property. Is that remaining? And is that a large tree? I noticed there's a lot of canopy coverage. I couldn't tell whether that was the neighbor's tree or this tree.
There was a large tree in the rear of this lot that was already removed, I want to say a year ago, and was replanted. So there are several small trees at the very rear of the lot, but no trees will be removed as a result of this project.
So we can look forward to 15% canopy coverage?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions from any commissioners?
I do.
Who's I do?
Commissioner Newman, I believe.
Oh, Commissioner Newman, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So am I correct that the additions that are proposed do not increase the non-conforming aspect of the house?
That is correct.
So under the new ordinance, if it were applicable in the coastal zone, which it isn't yet due to the delay in getting the coastal approval, this would comply with our ordinance.
That is correct.
Okay.
Any other questions?
On the parking, maybe this is something, I don't know if the applicant's going to speak or not, but I noticed in front of the house there are no parking signs, which I'm concerned about the parking to start with. And then do you know who is responsible for putting no parking signs on the street in front of the house, and whether that ties in any way with the application?
No, I'm unaware of no parking signs in front of the residence.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, seeing none, this is a public hearing, and it's time for the public to make comments. And first, is the applicant present? Mr. Mininger or Mrs. Mininger?
He is present. I'm going to allow him to speak.
This is Sean. Kevin Mininger is here, and they have their hand raised.
Okay. Mininger, go ahead.
Hi, thank you, Commissioner. So the no parking signs were on the adjacent property. There aren't any in front of our house, although it's pretty common within Depot Hill for people to put no parking signs when they don't have any off-street parking in front of their house. We're just looking to create a little more space for our family and be able to utilize the property.
Okay. Are there any questions for Mr. Mininger?
Yes, I do.
Commissioner Newman?
I just wanted to follow up on that. I visited this house today, and the signs were right in front of your house.
So, yeah. Matt, could you go back to the photo of the house?
Yes, it's up.
The ADU next door, which looks very similar because they're very similar in color and scale and size, does have no parking signs in front of their house or residence, in front of the gate there. So that may have been what you saw. I would imagine. So we haven't put any signs up in front of our house. So.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Manager. We'll bring it back to the commission for discussion. Who would like to lead off?
First, I'd like to report that there's no written public comment either.
Is there a motion?
I have comments if no one else does.
Okay, Mr. Newman?
So I think that the new parking spaces that are proposed are very problematic, but maybe it's the best that they can do. I mean, a 7-foot parking space in tandem in front of an 8-foot parking space. I hate to set a precedent for that kind of variation of the parking ordinance. It's really, I mean, for a lot of vehicles, it's just not viable. I just throw that out. I'm not going to hold up the project on account of that. But I would like to see a condition that there, because I think the parking is so problematic, that there not be any no parking signs in front of their property in the public road.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Newman. We did approve a similar application up on Fanmar, where the parking spaces were, I think, very similar in size to this.
Well, they were small. I'm not sure that they were 7 feet, but were smaller.
Okay. Any other commission comments?
Yep.
Susan?
This is Susan Westman. I agree with Commissioner Newman. I was quite concerned about the parking and did visit the site, and it's clear that they are using those two areas for parking for their residents right now. And while I'm going to vote for this particular project, my overall concern is that one of the goals in our zoning ordinance is to continually improve our community. And I think we want to be careful by making exceptions which don't improve the community when you have a project where the majority of the structure is going to be torn down and rebuilt. This one may not be as bad as some because the additions in the back, but I think we want to be careful in the future of not requiring adequate parking as parking becomes more of a problem in all of our neighborhood as more ADUs are added and more density is added. This particular project I was willing to vote for because basically it's a zero lot line development and it's the same next door. And I make the assumption that when that project comes in, they will be asking for the same kinds of variances that are being given tonight. And in this particular situation, it seems to work. But I do caution us in the future to not give up too much of the standards that we want to see implied and that we've just adopted in our new zoning ordinances.
Thank you, Susan. Any other comments? Hearing none, I have a comment. It's somewhat related and somewhat unrelated, but I don't think I can count the number of variances that the city has granted for people to encroach in the 10-foot unused right-of-way on Depot Hill. And just perhaps it's time to consider abandoning that unused right-of-way so we don't have to deal with all these variances every time. So with that comment, I will call for
Mr. Christensen.
Commissioner Newman?
Mr. Christensen had a comment.
So Commissioner Christensen.
Hi. I was curious as to why reading through the historical report and reading the Arkin site comments, I've seen when design and mapping is a concern or at least an item that's addressed with historical structures, why isn't there a material board presented. I believe that was a requirement, and I'm not, just considering a black and white design of masting is fine, but I'm just wondering when considering how it fits into the landscape, you know, on the streetscape, just there's no description of color and I understand we could go out there and look, but what are they proposing exactly with how this is going to be finished off? I see C-shaped shingle on the top and then horizontal siding on the bottom, but I was just wondering.
You may remember a recent discussion about this with Commissioner Wilk, where there was a difference of opinion, but we do have in our application color materials board that we don't hold people to currently. And I know there's different feelings about whether or not that should be required, but we really don't regulate color. And in terms of siding, we would look at that more if this were a truly significant historic resource. With this one, the preliminary historic review determined that it was not in and of itself historic. So that really wasn't part of the design review. It did come up at the Arkin site, and the design was amended. It was strictly horizontal on the first and shingle on the second, I believe, or the other way around. And then they, our local architect, Frank Banton, recommended taking the siding from the bottom all the way up to the windowsill of the second story. As kind of a design effect. But generally, if it's not one of the defining historic characteristics, that's not something that we would get into in detail. Yeah.
I remember that discussion based on the materials board back then, and then seeing a project that's addressing, you know, historical structure. It would be helpful to see materials and what they're actually proposing, instead of just the black and white line drawing.
It is a requirement of our
application. Any commission response to Courtney? I would concur with her.
Yeah, I agree with her too. And it's just like we get landscape plans when new projects are coming in, and there's nothing that says that landscaping is not going to change over time. Someone can certainly change the color of their building over time, but when they're going through a design review process, it seems like the kinds of materials and colors are important to how the design's going to look. So I would like to see those materials and colors. And that doesn't mean we have to hold up this project tonight for this, but I'm speaking for in the future.
Yeah. For future projects.
Yeah.
Okay. So it looks like just as a kind of unofficial directive, we have a majority who would like to see those color boards in the future. And, are there any other comments regarding that?
Times change.
Okay, so are we ready to call for the
guardy?
Do we have a motion on that project?
I'll make a motion to approve the project with the conditions listed in the staff report.
Okay, well, a motion by Mrs. Westman to approve the project. And does that include Commissioner Newman's additional condition?
It does, that there will be no parking signs placed in front of the residence.
Okay, and do we have a second?
I will second.
Hey, Courtney Christensen seconded it. So we can now have the roll call, please, Edna.
Sure. Commissioner Christensen? Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
Chair Ruth?
And Commissioner Ruth votes yes. So the motion carries, and Mr. Manager, you have your project.
Can I clarify one thing about the condition? Is that no parking signs just in the public right-of-way or on the front of the property at all?
On the front of the property.
Okay, so just making sure, because originally it was public right-of-way.
You'd have to go through the city procedure if they want to make that street no parking or, you know, their normal signage procedure.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
That brings us to the next item on the agenda, public hearing item B. This is 201 Capitol Avenue, and it's a design permit and conditional use permit amendments for a new entryway, windows, and an awning for an historical commercial structure located within the Central Village. Matt?
Thank you, Chair Ruth.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Do I have to recuse myself from this? This is Commissioner Wilk.
Yeah, Commissioner Wilk and Commissioner Newman should be recused from this item.
Okay. So this is Commissioner Newman. I guess I'm recused because of proximity, according to the staff, although that puzzles me because I've acted on various mercantile applications over the years. But anyway, I guess maybe the distance has changed. So we'll see you after this hearing.
Still 500 feet, right?
Still 500. Maybe 500 feet has changed.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Newman. Okay, Matt, go ahead.
Thank you. The existing commercial structure at 201 Capitol Avenue is a historic two-story building on the southwest corner of Capitol Avenue and San Jose Avenue. You did see this recently. It just went through last year, actually, for a similar permit. The 5,140 square foot lot is adjacent to Capitola Mercantile to the south, Capitola Candy Company to the west. The structure currently contains three commercial suites. Capitola Avenue contains one and two-story structures with residential uses on the first, retail uses on the first story. Project requires amendments to design permit and conditional use permit approved last year under permit 190375 on March 5th, at the beginning of last year's craziness. So we have a site plan showing the three suites, the previously approved new entrance along San Jose Avenue, and the proposed new entrance along San Jose Avenue. These are the floor plans showing the existing floor plan at the top, the floor plan approved under permit 190375 with the recessed shared entrance along San Jose Avenue in the middle, and the proposed floor plan with a new second entrance along San Jose Avenue along the bottom. Here's some elevations showing the existing San Jose Avenue elevation at the top, the San Jose Avenue elevation as proposed, as approved under 190375, with the recessed shared entrance along San Jose Avenue in the middle, and the proposed one tonight, elevation with a new second entrance along San Jose Avenue at the bottom. The applicant is proposing to replace the previously approved recessed entryway with an entryway to suite one that is flush with the building facade, and to add a second new entrance to suite number two that is flush with the building facade as well, and an additional awning and three-pane second-story window to the south. Modifications are designed to maximize the visibility of the entrances to the two suites, and the proposed design will maintain sharply arched, fluted, square, streamlined columns of the historic structure. The proposed project includes a significant alteration to the historic structure. Significant alterations to a historic structure require approval of a conditional use permit by the Planning Commission, and any modifications to a historic resource must comply with the Secretary of the Interior standards in order to qualify for a California Environmental Quality Act exemption. In considering an application for a conditional use involving the material change of a historic feature, the Planning Commission must weigh the benefits of the proposed change against the detriment to the public welfare caused by the change in the feature. So in approving any such change, the commission shall make one of the two following findings, the one shown here, that it will not be significantly detrimental to the historic feature, or that the applicant has demonstrated that the denial of the application would result in hardship that is so substantial as to outweigh the corresponding benefit to the public of maintenance to the historic feature. Architectural historian Leslie Dill reviewed the project for compatibility with the Secretary of the Interior's standards and found the proposed plan amendments comply. Based on the review by architectural historian Leslie Dill, the proposed modifications will not be significantly detrimental to the historic structure at 201 Capitola Avenue, so finding number one can be made. So the cut staff recommends Planning Commission review and approve project application 20-0444 based on the conditions and findings for approval.
Hey, thank you, Matt. Are there any questions for staff in this?
Yes, I have a couple questions.
Commissioner Westman?
So I want to make certain I understand what's going on here, because to be honest, I found looking at the plans a little difficult. Are they proposing to add on, I know there's an awning over the new door for the residential unit, but are they going to propose to have awnings over these new storefronts?
Yes.
So that's what is shown on the plans. I mean, it almost looked like they were trying to create some sort of little balcony over the windows, and I wanted to make certain that wasn't happening. It's just going to be awnings.
Yes, they're awnings.
And do we know what color or style of awnings those are going to be? Or
I believe they were supposed to match the ones on the east and north corner that are on the very right-hand side of the picture you see here. And those were actually supposed to be replaced as well with new awnings of a similar style as well, as one of the conditions that are from the last permit that are being carried forward with this modification.
Okay. Thank you for answering those questions.
Okay. Thank you, Susan. Any other questions? Mark Christensen?
It's kind of within the same vein as the last comment. I just want to see how they, I know that the historical report says that it's consistent with the design of the building. I just kind of want to see the window, how they plan to execute the sash and the awning and all that other, how it all kind of goes together. I think it's going to bring lots of life to that building and to downtown Capitola. But I was wondering if there's any way to get more depth with their design, being that it's on the main area at Capitola Village.
Yeah, there are some conditions from last time regarding bullnose stucco around the windows, anodized aluminum window frames, and I believe a few other details that were specified by the historian that are included in those conditions of approval and should be included in the plan set as well. I know that doesn't, you know, visually demonstrate them, but those notes will be in the plan set, and it will be constructed with those design elements.
Does that meet your concerns, Courtney?
Yeah, I mean, generally, I'll look into it.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions or comments? Okay, if not, then we'll open up the public portion, and if the applicant's present, he can tune in right now. If not, if there's any public comments, we'll give you a few minutes to make your comments heard.
All right, we have Frank Fenton here, the representative of the project, raising his hand.
Okay, Mr. Fenton, go ahead.
Hello there, can you hear me?
Yes.
I was just going to say, on the drawings that we submitted in response to Courtney's, we did show, like Matt was talking about, and the historian wanted to see, on the right of sheet A3, it's cut off of the thing that Matt's showing, but we did match those existing windows that are along Capitola Avenue. With the around the edges, and we showed how then there's going to be like stucco kind of, yeah, bullnose and wrapping into the holes, and then those awnings are going to be corner round, a quarter round, and a blue canvas that's going to match, like Matt was saying, the new awnings that are going to be right around that corner there with Capitola Avenue and San Jose Avenue. I just wanted to jump in with that and say hello to everybody, because, you know, quarantine and everything.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Fannin. Courtney, do you have any other comments? You're happy now?
Yeah, I'm good. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else have any comments? Okay, this is a public portion again, and if anyone else wants to participate, now's the time. We'll give you a little bit of time here to join in. Doesn't appear to be anyone entering into the public portion, so
Chair Ruth,
with
there,
that, we'll...
there are no comments via email either.
Yeah. Okay, with that, we'll close the public portion and bring it back to the commission. Commission comments or questions? Any more?
No, I don't. You want a motion?
I'd love a motion.
I make a motion to approve the project with the conditions in the staff report.
Do we have a second?
A second.
That's the important.
Yeah. Commissioner Christensen, seconds. Okay. May I have the roll call, please, Edna?
Sure. Commissioner Christensen? Commissioner Christensen?
Edna, are you there?
Yes, can you hear me at all?
We'll call the roll.
Well,
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. I think this will be a nice addition to that building, and hopefully it gets filled because it sat vacant for so long. Okay, public hearing C has been postponed, and that brings us to the director's report. Katie, anything to report?
I have some really great news to report to the Planning Commission. So that's, the Coastal Commission has reached out and they are bringing our zoning code update forward next month at their April meeting. They were trying to get us onto their March meeting, but there are some things going on with, I think, ATVs and dunes down south that is consuming all their time, but I'll be getting an official letter from them soon, but they have given me the heads up that they're moving forward. And I think they identified, they mentioned that the letter will contain three or four items that they'd like to see modified within the code. But the big picture is that they're accepting the majority of our requested changes. So I'm looking forward to that. And just a reminder that within our zoning code update that we submitted, the non-conforming chapter as well as the geological hazards was not included in that update because the direction, it's kind of a moving target at the Coastal Commission right now. They're putting out some guidance documents, so they put out one that was highly controversial. So we're not submitting those two chapters at this point, and that's something that will come back to the commission. In between, as time permits, we'll be moving forward with an IHO update, the Inclusionary Housing Ordinance update next. So, but great news on the Coastal Commission. So I'll bring you more up to speed next month once I have some official documentation from them. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Katie.
What happens to those two chapters if they approve the zoning ordinance? Are they old ordinance?
The old will stay in place, and they'll just be they'll be renumbered into our new updated code.
Oh, boy.
Okay. And then we have to turn around and amend the zoning ordinance to conform with the new state housing standards, right?
Yes.
The subjective and objective ideas?
Yes, that'll be coming forward as well, so.
Okay.
You'll see that IHO update, okay, and then objective standards, and then we'll be probably non-conforming and geological hazards after.
So. Yeah, okay. All right, Mr. Newman, you had some items you want to, or some information you want to bring up about the sign ordinance.
Right. I'd like to just get input from the other commissioners on this. I kind of want to not be chewing on this bone for the rest of my career as a planning commissioner, and I want to kind of figure out what the best direction to go on this. But the issue as I see it is this: we have very strict sign ordinance in Capitola, and when people come in for projects, we impose strict signage requirements, and I'm particularly concerned about 41st Avenue, but there's rampant non-compliance and violations of the ordinance, and particularly with the street side signs. And I understand that the staff doesn't have necessarily the bandwidth, or it's not really what they want to do is be sign policemen every day. And I certainly don't want to. So I'm trying to figure out what the best approach to this problem is. Some of the alternatives that occur to me are, one is to do nothing and just kind of make it an honor system. Those who want to comply with the sign ordinance do so, and those who don't, don't. Figure out some way to actually enforce it. And for example, CVS has got like six flags out in front of their property now on the street, advertising services that they're providing. We know that the mattress firm place has been playing a cat and mouse game for a long, long time. And there are others too. And some of those small businesses, I understand, have been struggling. And so they're doing everything they can. But, you know, it has a chance of becoming rampant. It's already, I think, as soon as other people see signs out there, then why should they not put their signs out there? And it's not really fair to allow one person to do it another. So another alternative is just not to impose sign ordinance requirements on businesses anymore, and kind of let everybody do whatever they want legally. I guess that's more for the city council. So I'm kind of scratching my head as to, you know, how to deal with this problem.
Mick can go ahead first, but I have a comment too.
Yeah, Susan, go ahead.
I personally think that the sign ordinance ought to be enforced if we're going to have a sign ordinance. And sometime in the past, I don't know exactly when, you know, it seemed that code enforcement in Capitola went to this attitude, it's only enforced if someone complains. And I think that's a really bad approach, because you put an awful lot of people in an awkward situation that they have to, you know, call City Hall and complain about another business or their neighbor to make anything happen. I sympathize with staff that they have a lot of work to do, but I do believe it's one of their sort of charges is to enforce things like the sign ordinance. And if they would, you know, like some help, you know, say, if you guys will just email me signs, we will take care of them, because we don't have time to, you know, go around and look at them. You know, I'm certainly willing to try and help or be part of that process. But we have always wanted to have 41st Avenue be an exceptional, you know, shopping area that attracts people. And I would hate to see it turn into, you know, just sort of a junky strip mall section of street. So I would like to see the ordinance enforced.
Can I sit down for 1 second? This is going to turn into a real discussion. We should really agendize it for a future meeting. Just because this wasn't included on this agenda as a discussion item. So I don't want the city attorney to reprimand us here.
Yeah, I mean, it would be fine with me to talk about it at a different
time. Yeah, I'd be happy to discuss it as well, because there's a similar situation occurring with the Environmental Committee on recyclable plastics and disposable containers that also is not being enforced. So it'd be curious to see if the general discussion on code enforcement.
Maybe we should have a study session to discuss these various things.
So I can take your comments to the city manager. Code enforcement, since I've been here, has been just as Commissioner Westman explained. We follow up on complaints that come in. I definitely agree that you know, we've seen increased violations with COVID-19 of businesses under extreme stress. But, you know, there's banners everywhere. I I have checked in on this recently about our approach, but I think we can revisit this and see if the council would like us to take a more proactive enforcement. But it's great to get the Planning Commission's feedback on this for me to take it to the to our city manager. So I think it's okay to.
You know, my idea would be we have a lot of bodies in City Hall, and I'm sure they cover a lot of areas in Capitola when they're out and about. I think if Jamie would hold a general staff meeting and give the planning staff just an opportunity to outline what the ordinance entails in brief, so we have everybody in City Hall being observant who could then report violations. It would sure put a lot more eyes out there.
And we have in the past, a couple years, actually, Commissioner Wilk will relate to this. We hired an intern at one point to do a sweep of our, we had a lot of in compliance with our vacation rental ordinance, and Joanna Wilk was hired as an intern to help us do a sweep. So that is something I think we can definitely step up our game on. So I appreciate this being brought up this evening.
Okay. Any other commission communications? Thank you, Katie.
I had one more. I went for a walk today and noticed that someone had strung an extension cord across their balcony across the sidewalk to plug in their car. And I think electric cars are here to stay, and they're going to be more and more. So I would sometime like to talk about when or should we, you know, require major remodels and new construction to make provisions for charging electric vehicles, and, you know, how are we going to deal with the issue of, like, someone charging their car in the street from an extension cord from their house, because it's coming.
I think that
there is a green building code that we have that maybe could be addressed in that light.
Well, I'm sorry to interject, but I believe that all new buildings, I'm almost positive, need to have an EV electrical vehicle implement as just for a building permit. I'm almost positive.
No, they do for commercial. I didn't know that they did. You know, like the project we looked at tonight, they're going to underground their utilities. I mean, there's going to be a lot of electrical going on there. Is that something we should start considering? I'd just like the Planning Commission to talk about it a bit.
Okay. Any other communications at this time? Okay. I just have one. I will not be in attendance at the April meeting. So, Commissioner Wilk, you get the chair.
It's on, huh?
Yeah. And that's it. If there's nothing else, last chance, or the meeting's going to be adjourned. Okay, meeting adjourned.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Bye.
Goodbye.